Frank Montero has been on our board since almost the very beginning. He is the co-managing partner of Fletcher, Heald, and Hildreth. He's an expert on wireless and broadcast law with great distinction. And I'm going to turn the floor over to him. Frank, thank you very much.
Okay. Is it okay if I close this? Thank you, everybody. It's wonderful to see you all here, and I'm delighted to be here. I think we're going to have a really, really good panel today. We've got a good topic, for some, very controversial topic. So I think you're all going to enjoy it. We've got, by the look of things, the battle lines drawn on the dais here. But before we start, one order of business. Upstairs at the luncheon, someone found a BlackBerry. So if you are missing a BlackBerry, are you? It's over at the conference planner's desk, so she may have it now. And secondly, before we start, I'd like to introduce Blair Levin, who is going to be giving the keynote address here as a lead-in to our conference discussion, and we'll be no doubt talking about some of the issues that we'll be discussing during the panel. Blair is with currently the Aspen Institute, but really, for anybody who's been involved in broadband and in the and in the chairman's broadband plan, knows that he's a major architect that was involved in all that work. And anyone who has been practicing before or as a participating before the Federal Communications Commission, he really needs no further introduction. He's known pretty well throughout the industry as a policy planner in the communications and telecommunications space. So without any further ado, I'd like to introduce Blair.
Thank you. And first, let me thank David for inviting me. Congratulations on another very successful year for this organization. David invited me for a number of years, and I don't know whether it's a desire that I say controversial things to keep everyone awake right after lunch, or it's a secret conspiracy between David and my wife to make sure that I've said enough things that I will never be confirmed by the Senate for any government post. Hopefully I won't disappoint you in either regard in this case. So what David asked me to do was to address the question, will the spectrum goals of the National Broadband Plan be achieved? The answer is no. Thank you very much. No, I said that as a joke, but I'm quite serious about the answer. I say it with a great deal of pain. Actually, jokes are how all minority groups, and particularly us Jews, deal with our pain. But I'm very proud of the spectrum chapter of the National Broadband Plan. In fact, proud that there even was one, because anyone who's looked at a lot of other countries knows that they often only dealt with wireline issues. For a while, I was quite optimistic we would march quickly toward our spectrum goals, but I fear that we've gotten off course. There are many reasons, but my prime concern today is the House spectrum bill. Now, my conservative friends taught me, actually in my first effort at government service back in the mid-90s, they taught me something for which I'm very grateful, that government has to have a humility about its actions and face the future with a flexible approach that accommodates our inability to know the future. And we followed that advice with the plan. Our proposal for incentive auctions reflects that humility and flexibility, as it does not prejudge the relative value of spectrum for broadcasting, broadband, or any other use we might have. Rather, it is a market-based mechanism for reallocating spectrum to its highest use as opportunities change. Now, some urged us in advocating incentive auctions to recommend capping the amount of spectrum an individual company could buy. Others asked us to prescribe allocations between different uses of spectrum, exclusive, unlicensed, opportunistic, each of which can fuel different ecosystems that benefit consumers in both a complementary and competitive way. We didn't do either of these, not because we thought spectrum caps were always bad or because we didn't think unlicensed or opportunistic uses are valuable, but because many things can happen between now and when the rules of an auction are established. Mergers, technology developments, changes in consumer preferences, rejection of mergers. Who knows what's going to happen? These issues are best evaluated when you look at the data of the day. How much spectrum is being reallocated? What's the existing spectrum allocation? What are the current barriers to entry? Has technology facilitated more reuse or better use of higher or lower bands? Has spread spectrum or cognitive radios changed the game? Has Wi-Fi offload or non-mobile uses changed the market structure? Many questions. So while we passionately believe Congress should authorize incentive auctions, we did not attempt to dictate the details on timing, repacking, experimentation, and a myriad of others. We knew, because many of us had worked there, that we were giving the expert auction staff at the FCC a difficult task. We thought it would best to let them figure these out and then let the actual proposal be thoroughly debated during the NPRM process. So nearly 2 years ago, we were hoping that Congress, in which there is a rare bipartisan agreement on the wisdom of incentive auctions, would quickly pass a one-sentence bill that says the FCC shall have authority to share auction proceeds with any licensee who turns in its license to allow that spectrum to be auctioned. 2 years later, we still have a bipartisan consensus on the wisdom of incentive auctions, but we have no new auction authority. Rather, we have a long, complicated proposed piece of legislation, much of which I agree with, actually, but that nonetheless has many elements that sadly violate the most basic elements of the wise conservative advice about government humility that we took in developing the plan. The House proposal locks in a variety of decisions, none of which need to be or should be decided now as to timing, spectrum caps, uses, experimentation, and other items. Now, if I used to work on Wall Street with Rebecca, who spoke at lunch, and if I were to propose that we adopt a rule that would force a mutual fund to decide which stocks they wanted to buy a year before they executed the trade, you would think me crazy, and I would be. Yet that is similar to what this legislation would do. Now, to be fair, some see it differently and argue that any FCC objection to Congress acting as proposed is an example of trying to take away congressional power. Believe me, I worked for Reed Hunt. If there was a way to take away congressional power, we would have done it. But we didn't, and we couldn't. And this argument, frankly, with great respect to those who make it, is downright silly. The FCC cannot take away congressional power. As a matter of law, Congress always has the final word. If the FCC were to propose auction rules or make any auction-related decision that Congress did not like, Congress would have at least a year, the minimum time it takes to go from rulemaking to auction, to take action to modify or reject the proposal, as Congress has done in the past, including stopping an auction a day or two before it was about to start. Perhaps the most humorous commentary, though unintended, was Scott Cleland's comment that by asking Congress, that Congress give it the flexibility to design an auction that reflects the best available knowledge, quote, the FCC is clinging to an obsolete government knows technology best mindset where government imagines it is better at picking technology and market winners and losers than users and market forces are, end quote. As the legislation on its face does exactly that, Scott apparently is taking the view that Congress is not a part of the government, which, like Dick Cheney's view that the vice president is a fourth branch of government, deserves points for constitutional creativity. Or perhaps Scott believes all spectrum should be auctioned, which would mean the great benefits of Wi-Fi today and perhaps white spaces tomorrow would never be realized, which is a bit odd, as I remember Scott fervently praising in the New York Times the 2002 FCC decision on ultra-wideband, which made a number of technological decisions and depended on non-licensed spectrum as creating the possibility of, as in his words, Star Trek stuff. Now, Scott's prediction, at least to date, has not proven accurate, but my point is not to say that he made a bad call. Rather, I actually have a great deal of respect for Scott. He's a smart guy. If he can make a prediction that big in the New York Times that wrong, we should all be humble about our ability to foresee the future. Now, nonetheless, just as an investor has to at some point in time decide to buy or sell a stock, at some point the government does have to make a call on how to proceed with a myriad of questions that an auction entails. Prejudging those decisions, like prejudging the purchase of a stock, dramatically increases the risk of error. So why do it? Now, I understand some are upset by various FCC decisions in the past that they feel were wrong, such as how the FCC tried to auction the D block in the middle of the last decade. Now, actually, I agree with some of that criticism, but it reminds me of Mark Twain's insight that a cat who sits on a hot stove never sits on a hot stove again and never sits on a cold one either. Congress, like the cat, in my view, is overcorrecting. Moreover, Congress should recognize it had the power to fix those errors. The fact they didn't again is not a criticism of Congress or the FCC. It's reflective of the fact it's difficult to predict the future, and therefore you want to wait to make the decisions until you have to. The notion that Congress should restrict the expert staff in its design of an auction that will occur at the earliest in 2014 by having Congress place restrictions on them that the critics wish had been put in place a decade earlier makes as much sense as the Maginot Line, which was the defense strategy that post-World War I generals in France adopted after the Great War and which proved utterly ineffective in World War II. Now, some supporting the House bill do make valid points. For example, Bob Quinn of AT&T suggests that if the FCC wants to retain the right to impose any spectrum caps, it should do a rulemaking on the subject, which I'm perfectly fine with that. I think it's reasonable in principle to examine whether one or two players should be entitled to buy all the new spectrum that comes onto market. But it's odd that the House thinks it's in a position today to say there's no conceivable change in the market that would justify any kind of constraint on who would be eligible to participate, and no conceivable change in technology that might increase what we want to allocate to unlicensed or opportunistic uses. In short, the question is not who has ultimate authority. The law already decides that. The question is about who makes what decision when. That's the question. Who makes what decision when? And the simple decision to let the FCC figure out how to do something no one else in the world has done is all we need to do now and all we should do now. There's no need to impose arbitrary constraints. If they don't like what's happening, there will be plenty of other opportunities to act. Now, that's not my only problem with the legislation. I've noted elsewhere that by writing language that enables a single judge to place the interests of individual broadcasters over the broader public interest, the bill creates significant risk that the auction will produce less spectrum, less money than optimal, and certainly less than anticipated. Now, one of the staff authors of the legislation responded to that by expressing confidence that the $16 billion that had been scored would be achieved. And while I sincerely wish that an idea conceived around my conference table would produce that kind of return, for one thing, it would mean our little old broadband plan would have returned about a 10,000% increase in return to the federal government, which, I don't know, entitles me to some kind of medal or a place in the Guinness Book of Records or maybe lunch at the White House cafeteria or something. My pride should not corrupt my experience. It tells me, because of my experience in designing the original auctions back in the mid-90s, or I didn't design them, but I was in a lot of meetings with them, the real geniuses who did, that kind of vague language and that kind of threat of litigation can have a very devastating effect on what actually happens. So in the spirit of Mitt Romney, I hereby offer to that unknown congressional staffer, David, a 10,000 penny bet that the scored number will not be achieved if Congress adopts the House version, and I would be pleased to pay off the bet if I'm wrong, and I look forward to hearing whether he will accept. Now let me return to the impact of all this on the folks you represent. I think the House proposal ultimately hurts minority broadcasters as it limits their options as markets change. They should have the ability to monetize the spectrum they leased, particularly as it would capitalize their ability to adjust their business models to move to cable or over-the-top delivery if that's what they choose. I think it also limits the options of minorities and everyone by ultimately raising the cost of the key input in the broadband ecosystem, spectrum. Every study confirms that wireless broadband is incredibly important to minority communities. I don't know whether in the future it will fully substitute for wireline usage, but I do know that by artificially constraining spectrum, by mucking up an auction, by constraining the ability of Wi-Fi and opportunistic uses to meet consumer demands, we will place even greater burdens on minorities who seek to be full economic members of the information economy and society. In closing, I should note that while I am deeply troubled by the House bills, my concerns are bipartisan. For one thing, I thought the House bill was better on the D block and regret the Republicans gave up that fight. The one time I, a Democrat, wanted the Republicans to fight hard and they gave up. Oh, well. But I'm perfectly fine. I mean, I don't want to relitigate that issue. because I litigated it a lot while I was at the FCC. Moreover, there are a number of issues where there's plenty of blame or credit, depending on how you look at it, that goes to both sides of the aisle, in which we have not been making the progress that we who worked on the plan all hoped we would, for making more government spectrum available. We were certainly hoping for more action there, to getting the MSS spectrum in use, to resolving certain interference issues. Now look, these are all complex issues. I neither had all the answers when I was working on the plan, nor do I have them today. But no one should be under the illusion that we are actually achieving the spectrum goals of the National Broadband Plan. At the same time, we should all agree with the comment that I think Committee Chair Upton made the other day, that by addressing the need for new spectrum, we have more potential in this legislation to create jobs and economic growth than perhaps any legislation before Congress. As Tom Friedman noted in his op-ed on January 4th, this question should be on the front burners of both the presidential debates, but really for all policymakers. How do we gain a strategic bandwidth advantage for this country? Better spectrum policy, which includes incentive auctions, is certainly part of the answer. But we will only gain that advantage if we give the staff at the FCC the freedom to develop the options that then allow the political leadership at both the FCC and the Congress to then apply their policy preferences. Otherwise, it will not be the normal case of policy where we take three steps forward and two back. Rather, in my view, it'll simply be us taking two steps backward. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Blair. Well, I want to get started. As you know, our topic here today is spectrum reallocation and how will the broadband plan goals be achieved. And you know, basically the issue that's teed up here is, I mean, by show of hands, who has one of these in their pocket? Yeah. So, and I don't see any teenagers in the room, and if you're anything like my teenagers, yours are like mine, this is only going to grow. People are going to be becoming more dependent on it. But at the same time, it's going to be eating up more spectrum, more bandwidth, and so where is it going to come from? And that's sort of the critical issue. So I want to start, actually, by really beginning with the ground level here, because for those of us who are inside the Beltway, practice before the FCC, some of the concepts that Blair has discussed and that you've heard at this conference, spectrum auctions, spectrum caps, incentive auctions, need no explanation. But for many of you, some of you at this conference, maybe we ought to just sort of tee up the issue to begin with. So, I'd like to begin by asking Christopher what from, and let me also start by just introducing our panel here. I have Christopher Guttman-McCabe, Vice President of Regulatory Affairs of CTIA, which is the Wireless Association. I have Walter McCormick, President of the USTelecom Association. James Assey, Executive Vice President, National Cable and Telecommunications Association. Chris Ornelas, the Chief Operating and Strategy Officer from the NAB, the National Association of Broadcasters, and then my good friend Jim Winston, the Executive Director of the National Association of Black-Owned Broadcasters. Their bios are all in the book, so I'm not going to spend too much time on that, but I want to start with Chris and CTIA. What's your definition of spectrum allocation? What does it mean? Explain to the audience what the concept here is.
Sure. Thank you. And I want to say thank you to David also, and happy to be back again this year. At a macro level, at a high level, the idea is taking a finite, very amazing resource, spectrum, and finding a way to get it to a certain type of use. What we're talking about now is reallocating spectrum from certain uses to mobile use, or to wireless use, whether it be licensed or unlicensed, getting it into the hands of the companies and ultimately consumers that are, you know, taking advantage of these devices that we all just suggested we have. So for us, it's a matter of making sure that the government provides the resource, which only the government has really access to it. It's not like Walters, a lot of Walters constituency, or James, where you can, go to a local government and get the rights to dig up the ground and put down fiber or lay a line. In our space, to that resource that drives our products is in the air, and it's controlled or managed by the federal government. And so we're in front of the government asking for access to additional spectrum, and I think what gets lost a lot, this is unique, and I said, Blair talked about having a 10,000% return. What our industry is asking for is the right to spend tens of billions of dollars to buy this asset. So no one's asking for access to it for free, although on the license side, I guess unlicensed they are. But on the license side, we're asking for the ability to purchase the spectrum so that we can turn around and put it to use for consumers. That's the allocation or reallocation portion of it, taking spectrum from places where it's being underutilized or possibly underutilized, and moving it to another use where it will be utilized.
Thanks. Chris Ornelas, when CTIA says taking spectrum from places where it's underutilized and hasn't been utilized, what's he talking about?
Frank, it's Chris Ornelas. If you prefer, you can refer to me as keeping Americans safe during times of emergency,
okay.
Chris. So I think it's important, and I'll get to your question in a second. I think it's important to state very clearly at the outset that broadcasters, I think, are in alignment with many of the things that Christopher just mentioned. That is to say that if there is a need for more spectrum to sate the congested networks that the wireless folks are operating on today, we're happy to be part of the solution. That is to say that we have no objection to folks who want to get out of the business of broadcasting. And we've said that from day one. Our concern has always been that we protect those folks who want to stay and the viewers that they serve. And that's all we've really been arguing for on Capitol Hill and over at the FCC. And so when you ask the question, is there a better and higher use? What is Christopher talking about? I think that really gets to the heart of the question, right? I appreciate Blair's comments that the National Broadband Plan did not seek to prejudge sort of the value of broadcasting going forward. But the truth is that since the day it was released, the conversation in Washington has been about nothing but the value of broadcasters and the continued utility of that service going forward. So I'd just like to point out two quick issues. One, that argument is predicated on two things. One, that broadcasters aren't using the spectrum that they've been afforded. And two, that we have a dwindling and insignificant audience that we currently serve that necessitates that the spectrum be put to a higher and better use. I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, because you can go to the futureoftv.org and see a lot of this information, but basically, with respect to the first point, broadcasters promised during the DTV transition that we would provide to consumers free of charge cool new services, where before we were providing one programming stream, we promised robust high-definition television. We promised a multiplicity of new programming streams. We promised the potential for mobile digital television on all of these devices. And in all respects, we're delivering. We are delivering on the robust high-definition television programming that many of you watch today. We've added 1,800 multicast programming streams, many of which are specifically targeted to ethnically diverse communities, the economically disadvantaged, programming they can't find anywhere else. And we're rolling out mobile DTV in markets all across the country presently. So that's what we're doing with our spectrum. I think of more importance, I think, for this community is let's talk about why it's important that we protect broadcasting and why we've been fighting to protect your ability to continue to receive our signals free and over the air. The number that I think a lot of people like to throw out in Washington is that there's about 10% still continue to view their television programming for free over the air. Now, I'm not going to quibble over the number. We think it's closer to 15%, and we think it's growing as people look at new and different ways to consume media. But more importantly, when you drill down on that number, the folks that are relying disproportionately on our service are the African American community, the Hispanic, the Latino community. You know, my grandmother, who lives down in Harlingen, Texas, first generation from Mexico. I'm heartened when I go down to Harlingen because you get off the plane, you go down to the retirement community, you look around, and there's nothing but over-the-air antennas on top of every house. But you know, she watches exclusively over-the-air television and gets 40 channels for free down there. My mother-in-law, who lives in Silver Spring, Maryland, is also first generation from El Salvador, is an over-the-air television viewer. She watches Univision, Telemundo, Telefutura, all over the air and for free. And so what we're concerned about is that as Congress moves forward, as the FCC moves forward to construct rules around an incentive auction, is that folks who disproportionately rely upon our services aren't disproportionately impacted by the policies or the regulations that issue to affect this auction. You know, Congress and the FCC are going to have a large problem if this isn't done carefully. But more importantly, Blair, you're going to have to deal with my mother-in-law if she loses her free over-the-air service by virtue of a repacking that isn't carefully considered.
I'll be happy to talk to her about it. Believe me.
As will I.
Right.
So let me add, Walter McCormick, is this generational? I mean, you know, it seems like Chris is talking about his mother-in-law and his grandmother. I just was talking about my teenagers. Are we moving in a particular direction? Is that what the issue is here? That we have to is broadcasting? You know, the buggy whip and the wireless, the high-speed train, or what's the situation here?
Well, I
is this on?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I think in the context of a national broadband plan, if you look at sort of the aspirations of the nation, it is to have Americans connected. That we know that there are a variety of benefits in terms of economic activity, access to information, healthcare, public safety, that all are advantaged by the fact when Americans get connected, when they can communicate online all the time, it just it has a multiplier effect on our economy. I think it's for that reason that night before last, the President of the United States talked about how we have still an incomplete broadband network, that we need to have a complete broadband network. And clearly, spectrum is a very big part of that. And when you think about minority communities, one of the goals of the administration is to be able to get broadband out to minority communities so the minorities can participate even more fully in our information-based economy. And with regard to minority adoption, the good news is that it's up. But minority adoption tends to rely disproportionately upon mobile access. And so what you see is the average growth in adoption rates today is about 3.7 times greater for minority and disadvantaged groups than it is for non-Hispanic whites. But that's disproportionately adoption that's occurring through mobile broadband. I will finally say this. I know that a lot of people at lunch were wondering, well, why is a wireline guy, you know, going to be on a spectrum panel, and why is a cable guy going to be on a spectrum panel? And I think it's important to understand that if we're going to really have robust wireless connectivity, if we're going to really have spectrum efficiency in the United States, we have got to have very robust wireline and cable-based infrastructure. Today, 99% of all wireless communications travel by wireline facilities. Wireless data is going to grow 26 times over the course of the next 5 years. That means we're going to need to have even more robust investment in wireline facilities. You had opened the panel by noting that virtually everybody in this room has a smartphone or a personal communications device, but the vast majority of your devices are connecting to cell towers that are several blocks away from here rather than tying into a network directly here. So if we can integrate more fully, the goal needs to be able to have wireless communications dropping into a wireline network or a cable network as quickly as possible. You're going to get more robust wireless communications then. You're going to get better spectrum efficiency and spectrum reuse then. And the levels of investment that are going to be required are really quite extraordinary. Again, the president talked about deteriorating roads, and he talked about incomplete broadband build-out. With regard to roads, the United States government last year, as part of a stimulus package, spent about $47 billion on the Interstate Highway Program. Our industry spent about $66 billion on broadband build-out, and we're going to need to increase those levels of investment. Interstate highway system built largely with gasoline tax and toll revenues. Broadband build-out, entirely private sector investment. So I do think that I think that the spectrum issues are key to where our nation is headed in the 21st century.
Frank, if I may?
Yeah, please.
Your sort of threshold or opening question was, is it generational? And I think if you look at some of the statistics, particularly that come out of Pew on a regular basis, while it is somewhat generational, it really doesn't tell the whole story. I mean, the number I saw most recently is that 72% of people above age 50 have used mobile devices to access the Internet. So that doesn't leave a lot of room for a generational disconnect. The numbers, as you get lower, closer to 90%. But I think if we're talking in the context, I know Chris talked about his family members, but I think if we're talking about the broader context of the Hispanic community or the African-American community, the statistics are staggering about the use in that community of mobile, and Walter alluded to it. But I saw numbers as high in the Hispanic community as 89% of the Hispanic customers who have smartphones use it daily to access the Internet. So, we're talking about closing a portion of the digital divide with devices that are just exploding in what they can be used for. And it is not limited to just the youngest generation, although I agree with you, my youngest daughter uses it like it's attached to her. But it is being used by all of us. I mean, you see fewer and fewer laptops nowadays. And a statistic I saw just today for the first time is that when we went back to November of 2010, the number of percentage of people who own tablets, it was 4% in the white population, 4% in Hispanic, and 4% African American, 7% Hispanic. You fast forward to December, 2 months ago, and the numbers had basically doubled. It went from 4 to 10% in the white, from 7 to 9 in the African American, and from 7 to 10 in Hispanic. In 1 month, from December to January to today, the numbers all doubled again. So 19% of white people have tablets, 21% of African Americans, and 21% of Hispanics. I mean, those are, if you're a public policy person, no matter what you've got to be happy about that. That's a feel good number. But it's just showing you that this ecosystem is just exploding in a way that's almost immeasurable. I mean, to have a doubling in 1 month is just, a staggering change. And it's not. It's good business.
It is.
It's good Christmas. Yes, yeah.
Well, actually, and that's a good point. Good Christmas. I mean, let me focus on this. My daughters, go on YouTube, they go on Facebook, whatever. But I will tell you this much, that when we have a blackout, we turn the radio on. And we listen to what's going to happen, or we listen to that over the air. Is there a public safety component to this?
Of course there is. But one of the amusing things that occurred during the broadband plan was there was a winter blackout because of snow that kept everyone but our team away from work. And when this was reported that somehow the broadband plan team had gotten to work, a broadcaster said, well, if they got there, it was only because of the weather reports that they had gotten over radio or television. They apparently were not familiar with the nature of the people who work on broadband plans, none of whom, as far as I know, and let me illustrate it this way. If there was an emergency right now, how many of you are watching television or listening to a radio? Right now. Okay. How many of you could receive an emergency alert? One of the things we talked about is we're using the wrong technology. I mean, no disrespect to broadcasting, but I don't watch radio, listen to radio or watch television 24/7. This is like pretty close to me 24/7. And the functionality of this in terms of geography and iterations and two-way connectedness, much more valuable. The most valuable thing to me is my ability to communicate instantaneously with the four members of my nuclear family. And so that's the thing that I think is at jeopardy if we don't have the spectrum that we need. But I don't mean to criticize the broadcasters. They do a great job. I just think we got to look at where the technology is going and how do we improve the way we deal with disasters and with deep respect for radio and broadcasting. And this is not the reason for incentive auctions, but it is part of the greater piece that we need to move to that platform which enables the best kind of communication. And let me say also that, you know, it's nice that they say they're supportive of incentive auctions. It wasn't quite the way I remembered it, but I'm glad that they're now supportive of incentive auctions. The problem is, and I want to be clear about it, and this was I trying to say in the speech, they now have a legislation, and I could be wrong about this, but my interpretation of it is it gives individual broadcasters to find a judge somewhere who can basically hold up an auction on the grounds that even though the five members of the FCC appointed by the president, confirmed by the Senate, think that plan is in the public interest, if it doesn't treat an individual broadcaster appropriately in the eyes of a single judge, that judge's view is more important and can hold it up. And I worry about that because, I worked at the FCC. I was part of the first dozen or so auctions. I know how it works. And if you give individuals the right to threaten lawsuits, it changes what is already a very difficult process into what might become an impossible one.
I will say that coming this morning, there was a story about the University of Maryland developing their own mobile app for their phone, which they call M-Urgency, that the student body can download, whereby the university can receive and send information should there be a crisis or emergency on the university campus. I'll also mention that I heard about that story on NPR. So,
which you could also get streaming, but that's.
I don't want to entirely live James out of this, but go ahead, Chris. It sounded like you wanted something to say.
Just to briefly respond to some of Blair's points. He asked how many of you folks right now are sitting in front of a television if there was an emergency so that you could get our emergency alert services. And, of course, the answer is no one, right? But that just goes to show you that there are more than one way to look at this spectrum issue. If we had the ability to put our high-definition television chip or a television chip into this, or for that matter, a high-definition or an HD radio chip into these devices, you wouldn't need a TV or radio in front of you. Matter of fact, you'd be able to get all of your emergency alert services over this phone for free, and at the same time, we would be contributing to the offload of some of the congestion that they're predicting is going to happen on these wireless networks in the next 2 to 5 to 10 years. That is to say, by Cisco's own reports, the majority of the data, the congestion that's going to be generated on the wireless networks in the next decade is going to be video-based. And we kind of feel like we have a pretty good architecture for delivering video to the masses. And so, I think that as we think through the spectrum issue more generally, that the focus on spectrum as the only input to alleviate some of this congestion, I think is misguided. I think that we have folks here that are willing to step up, and if they want to get rid of their licenses, that's fine, and they can be part of that input. But I think there's a much broader conversation that needs to happen in Washington. And with respect to the second piece, what we lobbied for and what we argued for at the FCC and in the House bill were protections so that our viewers could continue to receive the free service that they get today. And what we actually arrived upon was a standard that said the FCC should use reasonable efforts to replicate existing service areas. Now, I don't think that that's an unnecessarily strict standard for the FCC to adhere to. I mean, for the lawyers in the room, you know that the courts traditionally give great deference to the FCC in these matters. So we thought that a reasonable approach going forward was to require that the FCC at least consider replicating the service that our viewers are currently receiving as they consider ways to sort of squeeze as much spectrum out of the broadcast band as they can for resale to the wireless community.
Just for the sake of history, the FCC would do that anyway. When we did the digital television transition, that's precisely what we did. But there was no, if, correct me if I'm wrong about that, the Congress didn't give us that standard, which meant no one had a right to go to court to sue. And what concerns me is the vagaries of litigation. And that's just, as a former chief of staff, that's just a practical reality. Is you've got to advise the commissioners about the risk factor of what any individual judge might think. And they might think something, well, yes, judges always give the FCC deference, except when they don't. And I know a lot of cases, painfully I know of a lot of cases where they've chosen not to.
All right, well, I'm leaving the Jameses out of this. And just to avoid confusion, you're going to be Chris, you're going to be Christopher, mm-hmm. you're going to be James, and you're going to be Jim. So, James.
Yes.
Another landline association.
Who am I and why am I here?
And yes. why are you here? But let me ask you, what's your take on all this? And are incentive auctions and spectrum fees, is this the right way to do this, to reallocate? Do you care? What's your take on this?
So I think let me back up and start from maybe the first point you made when you opened. Why are we doing this? And at the end of the day, I think all of us are essentially, as a matter of communications policy, trying to figure out what is the proper way to map the government-controlled assets in a way that marshals them to meet the demands and uses that customers are increasingly enjoying. I mean, as we scan the room, you know, you're looking at a lot of people who are using computers. I'm sure they're hooked up to Wi-Fi. They may be using 3G. And I think it's probably beyond debate for us to talk about the hockey stick with respect to the fact that all of us are going to have devices that are more personal, that we can use inside, that we can use outside, that there are going to be applications that are going to exist in the cloud that we're all going to want to access. And that's incredibly exciting because it offers all of us and all of the folks in the communities we live the opportunity to better their lives. But we have to provide a little bit of foresight, and that obviously is very difficult, and it's very hard to predict what the future is, and technology's littered with examples of people who made bold predictions that turned out to be completely wrong. So we have to, I think, approach this entire exercise with a little bit of humility. And one of the reasons one of the things that I wanted to talk about on here is really kind of the diversity of how consumers use and consume entertainment and services that they use over broadband. I think we're growing up now in a world where consumers, and you know, it's kind of a trite phrase, but we all want our services, our entertainment, where we want it, when we want it, on demand. And luckily we have the technology that enables us to do that. Sometimes that's through licensed uses, but quite often that's through technologies like Wi-Fi. You know, if you think about the amount of traffic that goes over Wi-Fi devices and the rapid expansion we've seen, I think 2012 is the year we're going to actually see we're going to cross the 1 billion mark for number of devices that have Wi-Fi chips embedded in them. We're already seeing extremely high levels of use. When people connect via their mobile phones, oftentimes they're connecting over Wi-Fi. With tablets, the percentage is even higher. So that's not to say that Wi-Fi is more important than licensed use or licensed use is more important than Wi-Fi and unlicensed use. We shouldn't try to divide this into kind of an either-or discussion. We have to recognize that the future for customers relies on both. And what's exciting is not only have we seen tremendous innovation in the unlicensed space as well as the licensed space with respect to applications, but technology is really allowing us to change the paradigm. And a number of cable companies are essentially building technology into their networks that turns their cable strands into a wireless access point. If you go from Philadelphia to New York, you are likely to run into hotspots that have been constructed by either Comcast or Time Warner or Cablevision, which will allow you, if you are a cable customer, to access on the go, whether you're at the train station or at the park or at the mall, your email, your watch a movie, whatever you want to do. And we're increasingly being able to see these technologies spin out. Just the other day, Bright House Networks in Tampa, Florida announced that they've gone live with 2,000 hotspots in the Tampa St. Pete area, and they plan to double that number by the end of this year. So I think there's some really exciting opportunities for us to recognize with respect to Wi-Fi devices. And I also would say that we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that there is a little bit of a symbiotic relationship, because not only are consumers and customers in general using unlicensed and Wi-Fi to get the services they need, but also many carriers, in fact, who are faced with spectrum capacity crunches are resorting to techniques and ways of essentially using Wi-Fi to get the traffic off of the congested networks and onto networks that can handle the load. So I think we are going to have both licensed and unlicensed uses of spectrum, and the consumer is not going to care. They're just going to want their stuff. But as we consider spectrum legislation and as we set the table for the communications future that we're going to all enjoy, I think one of the things that we're hopeful is that we recognize that the future is going to involve a lot of wireless technology, and the demands are going to increase not just for licensed uses but unlicensed as well.
Jim, Winston, tell me, let me ask you the question. What do you think of spectrum auctions and this method of reallocating spectrum? And how does it affect your constituency? I mean, do they get to play with the big guys here when the spectrum gets bought and sold, and or are they getting shut out?
The way you phrased that question, I'm reminded of an old African proverb: when the elephants fight, it's the grass that suffers. NABOB is the National Association of Black-Owned Broadcasters. We have ownership in our name because that's what we're about. We're about fostering policies that create ownership opportunities for African Americans and other minorities. And when we listen to the discussion thus far today, we've heard about African Americans as consumers. And I think that limits the conversation and colors what we need to be looking at in total. If you look at television ownership, there are approximately 1,300 full-power commercial television stations in America. African Americans, approximately 11% and 12% of the population. If we owned a representative number of television stations, we'd own about 130, 140 television stations around the country. If we owned only 1%, we'd have about 13 or 14 television stations across the country. Today, African Americans own 8 commercial full-power television stations in the United States. So when you look at this issue, there are different layers to this issue that aren't even being addressed in the discussion. I think one of the things we need to look at here is there a element in this conversation that ought to be addressing empowerment of minority communities? If all we're going to be is consumers, if whether it's wireless service or wireline service, if all we're ever going to be is consumers, then we've already lost, regardless of how the legislation comes out. So it seems to me that, that a broader conversation needs to be had. And I think when we look at legislation, if Congress is looking at legislation in this area, then there should be other, some other things on the table. In 1996, Congress abolished, I'm sorry, 1995, Congress abolished the tax certificate policy, which was adopted by the FCC in 1978, which was the single greatest program ever adopted by the federal government to promote minority ownership in the broadcast industry. So, you know, we've been trying to get that reinstated since 1995. If Congress is going to be doing legislation, we think the tax certificate should be part of this legislation. We think, you know, we think that there needs to be something going on in this legislation that gives us a shot. And when we look at the subject of incentive auctions, the first time I heard of incentive auctions about 2 or 3 years ago, I guess, and someone told me that they had been at a FCC briefing about the subject of incentive auctions. And somebody said, well, television's a pretty profitable business. Why would anybody be interested in auctioning off, giving in their license for an auction? And the FCC representative at the meeting said, well, we think there are some minority companies and small businesses that aren't doing very well, and they might want to sell out. So I'm looking at this, I'm saying, okay, there are 8 stations, and we're the guys that are looking to sell out. What's wrong with this picture? So, you know, I think, you know, and obviously, Chris makes an important point about over-the-air broadcasting. Minority audiences are the primary users of over-the-air broadcasting. You know, pay television is a concept a lot of people, you know, even if they like the idea, they can't afford. So minority audiences do represent a significant portion of the audiences that are getting free over-the-air broadcasting still. They're not cable or Dish Network or any other subscribers. And so it's important, you know, I'm pleased because it's not always the case that I can support the NAB position, and I'm delighted to do so today. We do believe that it's important that any auctions, if they take place, that they protect the service that minority audiences get as well. So I think, you know, I think there are two different issues here that I think need to be addressed. A is whether or not there are going to be ownership opportunities for minorities in the telecommunications industry going forward. And second, are we still going to continue to get service for those people for whom pay television is unrealistic?
Can I respond to that just very briefly? We have been focused, I think, a lot on this panel today about, at least I have, on how consumers take our free over-the-air television and what that consumer base looks like. But Jim's absolutely right. In terms of minority ownership opportunities for in broadcasting, I think that we acknowledge that there is a paucity of voices out there when it comes to the minority communities and the economically disadvantaged. Gordon Smith, our CEO, one of his last acts as a U.S. senator, in fact, was to reintroduce the minority tax certificates bill. And we're hopeful that, you know, as Congress takes up potentially more comprehensive telecommunications legislation in the future, that this will be part of the conversation. I will tell you that today, presently, absent a minority tax certificate program, that one of the few opportunities that minority communities can take advantage of in order to get their programming into this media marketplace is via our platform. That is to say, sometimes it's cost prohibitive to get on a pay TV tier, but we have multicast capabilities in every market across the country. Bounce TV is the nation's first ever over-the-air broadcast television network, and I'm happy to say that it launched in the fall of 2011. And as of January, it's in more than 50% of the country, reaching 72% of African-American homes. That's a good story. It's not the right answer in terms of ownership opportunities, but there is a platform there by virtue of us having multicast and delivering on the promise of multicast. There's Soul of the South that's launching in 2012. That's going to be offering the similar programming, and Kin TV. So there are a number of different African-American programmers out there who are finding a voice in the marketplace by virtue of us being able to hold and protect the audience reach that we have today.
Chris, can I ask you a question here? I'm sorry, Christopher. I don't think there's any doubt that your industry is going to need more and more spectrum. The demand from the consumer is going to grow. There's no doubt about it. But what we're talking about here is ownership. Is there another way to work? I mean, could spectrum be leased? I know when I was at the FCC, when Bill Kennard was there, there was an effort through the secondary markets to commoditize spectrum, make it bought and sold on the secondary market like it was, you know, pork bellies. Would that work, or does that not work from a technical level?
Sure. I mean, that works. Right now, we have a secondary market, and you see companies, you know, purchasing spectrum from, you know, you've seen satellite companies now move and try to become terrestrial mobile providers. You've seen mobile companies buy from other mobile providers. But I think what gets lost in this is, at its core, the idea of an incentive auction is voluntary. The only entities that give up their license or exit the market are those that choose to and want to monetize their assets. So if Jim doesn't want to do that and he wants to stay in, he has that opportunity. And some have argued, economists have argued, that it actually makes his asset more valuable because there are less of it that remain. But I also think limiting this notion of ownership or market is not necessarily the way to look at it sort of holistically. If you think about the fact that broadband gives business owners access to the internet-based economy and changes how you can, where you can, when you can, how much it costs to sell your product, and you think that all of a sudden you get small business owners. I know David just did an article that rebutted some of the points raised by Susan Crawford in an op-ed earlier in the year. And David's points were that, you know, there are a lot of businesses that are moving to mobile only and allows them to have a lower cost of sort of fixed cost. It also gives them access to a consumer base that they otherwise and reach that they otherwise wouldn't have. So I think if you talk about ownership solely in the context of owning broadcast stations, you know, there aren't a tremendous number of opportunities available now before incentive auctions kick in. And the idea of incentive auctions is just to provide an opportunity for companies to monetize an asset if they choose to. I think what we're talking about is much broader. It's allowing that internet-based economy, which is changing how all of us shop as consumers or sell as business owners, and providing that opportunity to, whether it's the African-American community or the Hispanic community or the non-minority community, it's just expanding the reach and making it both national and international in scope. And so there are different ways to do this. And obviously the laser focus has been on the broadcasters. The mobile satellite providers are equally as angry at my industry, as is the Department of Defense and all the other government agencies that own spectrum. So, you know, right now I kind of check under my car each day to make sure everything still looks good, no leaking fluids or cut wires.
I have to check twice.
Blair has to check twice. I don't park near Blair.
Right.
Yeah.
But, you know, the reality is...
Have somebody else turn the ignition.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm trying to get a wireless ignition, to start it, but that hasn't happened yet.
Yeah.
But, you know, the reality is what we're looking at is trying to find new mechanisms for reallocating spectrum. And the debate really is laser-focused on broadcast and broadcast spectrum. What we're saying is broadcasters currently have allocated 294 megahertz of spectrum in each market. Because of the setup of their networks, it's totally understood, but they don't use all of that. Is there a way to repack some of that and sort of scare out or bring out some of those spectrum resources? We're doing the same thing with the mobile satellite providers. We're doing the same thing with the Department of Defense and the Department of Commerce and all the others. Are there ways of bringing these assets to market? And the reality is every other country that we would compare ourselves to has done this. Past tense, has. Germany, UK, Spain, Italy, France, South Korea, Japan, China brought hundreds of megahertz of spectrum to market to fuel their ecosystem in order to catch the United States. We have 6% of the world's wireless subscribers. We have 87% of the highest high-speed wireless subscribers. We have an advantage now in the United States, and the goal is to keep that.
And if I could just say very quickly, I don't know who the FCC person was, but they absolutely did. They got it wrong. Part of what we're talking about, why do we care about the ownership? It's not just for the sake of owning spectrum. It's about the content. It's about the delivery of the diverse information. And so one of the things we heard, well, look, when the FCC decided there should be 32 broadcasters in Los Angeles or 25 in New York, that was before multi-channel videos, before over the top. Markets change, so let's have a reallocation. And if a broadcaster who currently owns 6 megahertz isn't doing high-definition programming, they really only need 2. Why don't we give them an opportunity to work with other broadcasters, get some cash so they can actually spend more on the programming, and figure out whatever the market forces cause them to do. And by the way, they can do that programming with an over-the-top or with cable and therefore get a better reach. But it's really about giving that freedom to do the rational economic thing and hopefully create more ownership and content opportunities.
I don't want to cut off Chris or Jim's opportunity to rebut here, but I do want to open it up to questions because we're going to have to wrap up here fairly soon. So with that, are there any questions from the audience for anybody on the panel?
I have one, but I wanted to wait if there's anyone else that has one first.
I think there's...
Hey, Eliza Kerman with Politico. So I don't know if you guys caught this, but earlier this week, Larry Strickling said that he only sees the need for spectrum growing in the federal government with things like drones and other nifty things that we want to do with the airwaves. That being said...
do we need spectrum in the United States for drones? Is Larry telling us something that I'm unaware of?
You'll have to take that up with him.
No, I know exactly what they're talking about. The question is, why do you need to tie up spectrum in New York when you're using it in Utah is really the question.
Right. But given that that's sort of where the man in charge of spectrum and the government is at, are there any concrete plans for the industry to share? I mean, frankly, all we hear from the press is, give it to us, we need it. You know, are you making any serious efforts to find ways to share the spectrum for both of your needs? This is to the whole panel.
Well, right now, sharing exists. If you look at the AWS spectrum allocation, there were geographic exclusion zones where the government used, got to keep or maintain operations. I mean, sharing can be defined as sort of temporal in nature. To Blair's point, sometimes in Utah there are training exercises, and so during X period of time of the year, certain bands of spectrum will continue to be operational for government. Same thing with geographic. We've seen exclusion zones. So sharing happens as it's be. And then there's the sort of Uber sharing, which is when will the technology be available such that two completely different uses can share a band and land on a block of spectrum and use it and get off without the other use knowing. And that's in the works. I don't think it's ready for commercial prime time yet, but I know that as the technology evolves, that's where ultimately we will go is having to share bands and share blocks of spectrum. Until we get to that point, the companies are asking for reallocation.
Any other thoughts on this from the other panelists? Some concrete things that are happening?
Just briefly. So I think this gets directly to the point that I was trying to make earlier, is that if broadcasters gave back all 294, which we have now, it would still not solve the coming congestion problems that are looming for the wireless networks. That is to say, there have to be other inputs in terms of making sure that these wireless networks work properly in the future. There has to be a technology solution. There has to be spectrum sharing. We have to look further into cognitive radios. We have to look at more robust infrastructure bills, tiered builds where we're using femtocells and picocells. I mean, there are any number of other technological solutions that should be pursued with just as much vigor as reclaiming spectrum, because at the end of the day, spectrum is but one input, and it's a Band-Aid, really, for a bullet hole.
Okay, I think the good-looking guy with the goatee has a question there.
let me bring this home. Much of what has been talked about, this kind of an elephant in the room, is should Congress write a brief statute that gives the FCC principal authority to make the rules? Or does Congress write a granular statute that tells the FCC what to do and the Commission issues almost
a self-executing order that does it quickly. Two good arguments for having the FCC do this, as Blair said, is the FCC certainly has more expertise, and further, as we know, the FCC is perhaps more sympathetic than much of the Congress to civil rights. Two arguments for having Congress write more granular rules are that much of what we want in terms of protecting designated entities, getting the tax certificate back, can only be done by Congress, and that we may not have time for the kind of long rulemaking that implements rules, that inherently draws lines that a court will later hold to be arbitrary, and it takes 5 years of appeals before you ever get the rules taken effect. Congress can pass a law, and that's pretty much going to be it. So it's a tough question, and I don't know the answer. Who is right? Blair, can I put you on the spot since you put this out there?
With all humility and flexibility, I'm right. look, I understand the issue, and I'm actually kind of sympathetic to the guys in Congress. And I think one of the things I learned, I mean, Reed and I, when one of the things we did wrong was how we tried to implement the 92 Cable Act by trying to cover every eventuality, and we, you know, wrote this 750-page order, and it was a work of great brilliance, and it ultimately fell apart under its own weight for a variety of reasons because we tried to do too much. And I think, you know, look, Congress could have passed a law 2 years ago with one sentence, and at least by now you would have actually had this very complicated thing done. And then Congress could have evaluated it, and the industry could have evaluated it. It's a hard thing to do. So in this case, I think I recognize the trade-offs, but to me, just give, I mean, if there's one thing we should all agree that the FCC has done very well over 80 auctions, not 100% right, and by the way, I love it when, you know, the Republicans say they're criticizing Kevin Martin. I'll be the first to, I mean, the biggest auction mistake ever was one that was done when Reed and I were there. It was the C block. I would differ as to what the mistake was, but and by the way, it was in trying to do exactly what you all would have wanted us to do or and did ask us to do. But the mistake was not what people commonly think it is. But we have to have forward progress. I mean, the notion that 2 years later we don't have anything, oh my God, I mean, what does that tell you? So I also agree with you, you know, I think it's dangerous to forum shop. I think you ought to be explicit about what we're trying to do. We ought to have a robust debate, either at the FCC or Congress, about it. And then we either get it or we don't, but then we move on. The critical thing, I think, is you know, Christopher was showing in that, is that minority communities increasingly rely on wireless as their broadband connection. They get their news that way. All kinds of other things are happening. The economic opportunities create that way. If we hit, I'm amused by the National Association of Broadcasters, which during my time was saying there's no spectrum problem, there's no spectrum problem. Now they're saying it's so big we can't even solve it with incentive auctions. So why bother? It's just a Band-Aid. Fine, whatever. But you know, it's an interesting change of position. Sometimes, you know, a Band-Aid helps for a while. I do agree, actually, that in the long run, we ought to be doing all these things, and we proposed all these things. But for God's sakes, let's move forward by giving the FCC authority to move forward.
Well, Frank, I don't know if we have can extend it just a few minutes, but I want to know if anyone has an opposing view.
Go ahead.
Well, I don't know if this is not necessarily opposing, but I say one of the things that I think we should all recognize, too, is this kind of an auction exercise is actually fairly unique. There are a lot of moving parts here. We have to essentially create the situation where the broadcaster will decide whether or not they're in or they're out. Then we're going to have to figure out how to both fulfill that and potentially repack other broadcasters. There are a lot of unknowns further down the line, and I'm not one to tell Congress what its prerogative is, but it seems to me it means that we ought to at least try to give ourselves as much flexibility as we can to encourage participation, to encourage our ability to assess what the needs of consumers are at the time that spectrum goes online.
We have time for one more, David? Take one more?
Right.
Yeah, one quick
I just want to interject and find out more concretely from Blair specifically, because I know you mentioned that you said most broadcasters aren't using the spectrum fairly.
No, I didn't. I never said that.
Well, you kind of alluded to how
broadcasters aren't using it. No, I didn't. I never said that.
Okay. Well, let me clarify my point. See, I'm a journalist by trade who happened to acquire a license in San Francisco, and with this digital spectrum, we've put on 20 different channels in the Bay Area serving all these different minority communities, African-Americans, Hispanics, Vietnamese, Filipinos, Taiwanese, Indians, and right. Americans. If you take away this spectrum, it's not really the big boys. The NAB will be fine. The CTIA will be fine. It's the little guys, the black-owned broadcasters, the handful of Asian-owned broadcasters like myself.
Yeah, but you start the sentence with, if you take away, who's taking away the spectrum?
Well, we're in the low power category, you know, the category oh, okay. that can't even get on cable
Thank
or
you.
Satellite.
Thank
you,
know, you for
clarifying.
You remember
those
right,
guys?
Right.
You know, we're not even allowed to have, we're not even allowed to be a part of the NAB. Mm-hmm. If you know the rules of the NAB, the NAB is an old 90-year-old club, and we're not even allowed to be a part of that.
Right.
So my point being is we can't get on cable, we can't get on satellite, we can't be a part of the NAB. The cards are stacked against us, period. Now, I've put on 20 channels. MMTC's facilitated a license for me in Chicago. There's not even a Chinese channel in Chicago. We're going to put on a Chinese channel and serve all these different minorities. So my point being is if you take away the little bit of spectrum that's left for the broadcasters, that's allocated for low-power guys who are actually serving local communities. We're not talking about homogenous programming coming from New York or coming from L.A. We're talking about real localism. That's what the FCC has been espousing. Is this the way you want the direction of the country to go in at this time when we have such diversity of thought and yet it's not getting out there in mainstream television whatsoever? I mean, I've worked for all the big broadcasters, and guys like me are on television. Guys like me are not in management. Guys like me are not in ownership. And low power facilitated an opportunity, and I've facilitated all these opportunities for women, Korean women, Vietnamese women, Indian guys who now own their own channels and are running stuff for local communities. So my point is, how can you bridge that divide? Because here we are espousing ownership, and it doesn't seem like we can be a part of that equation in terms of spectrum. It seems like the spectrum is going to either be with the big broadcasters or it's going to be with the big telco companies, and that's it. And all the independent guys will never be a part of that equation. So how can you counterbalance that?
The low power stuff is different for a variety of different reasons. But if your question to me is how can you destroy our business model, I would simply say, you know, that's actually not what we were proposing to do here. What we were proposing to do is reallocate spectrum, create a mechanism for a reallocation based on existing market conditions and consumer preferences over time. I mean, the question is, how do you do that? If we were to propose a rule, again, going back to a stock market analogy, which says that a mutual fund company can only buy stocks in companies that existed in 1955, that would be insane, right? Markets change. You want to be able to buy and sell stocks. Spectrum is the single most important asset other than maybe the national parks or something. But from the perspective of the communications infrastructure, it's the single most important asset controlled by the federal government. The question is, how does it get reallocated? And if what you're proposing, if what you're saying is there should be no reallocation scheme that in any way affects us, well, then I think we have to look at the broader public.
Let me just clarify real quick, because I know we're here on the Beltway, and you guys don't see what's going on California.
No, look, that's not fair. We met with you guys a bunch and tried to develop a plan that accommodated you guys.
There are 143 over-the-air channels in Los Angeles now. There are more than 80 in San Francisco. There are more than 80 in New York. The market is developing. DTV, you know, mobile is developing now. So the point is, why can't we all share in the spectrum, and why is it just the NAB, and why is it just the CTIA involved, and why can't we have more independent people involved in this particular business?
We're going to have to wrap up here. Because we have to bring up the next panel. This is a great discussion, and I really hate to cut it short, but maybe you guys can continue it out in the hallway. And please, everyone, stay where you are.
Everyone,
I want to thank our